I love to just expose myself to new places, new people, new worlds, new ideas. I'll take a walk in a place that I've never been to before and just pay attention to what's around me. If I see something that looks interesting, I'll just go up to it and I'll ask the person about, you know, what is this? Or hi, I'll introduce myself. I'll say, hi, I'm Anika. I'm here because I'm doing this. Your sign outside looked really interesting. I'd love to hear more. I am a naturally curious person. But of course, at times I do feel a little more subdued, but I think at that point, I just kind of tell myself, you know, it's time to get back out into the world again, because the world is such a rich place full of, you know, such a diversity of people, ideas, feelings, places, thoughts, you know, endless inspiration. I feel like if I just go outside and listen and open myself, I'll be inspired by everything that's happening around me. I'm constantly thankful. It is unconventional to be able to travel to so many different places. And the fact that I got to live with an Indigenous community for a year, the fact that I got to protest with them for 3 months and we won a case from the EPA, I'm very fortunate that my life has been such an adventure and I've been able to grow in so many of these different contexts. But at the same time, my life hasn't been without challenges. I've been in scenarios where I was made to feel like I didn't belong because of my gender and because of the color of my skin. I've been told before by a professor that I'm not just a pretty face, and that to prove I'm not just a pretty face, I should stay overtime and clean up the rest of the lab. I've also had to live with the consequences of fear in terms of not knowing what to do. Should I speak up? Should I not speak up? Should I put my career on the line? Especially when you're young, it's so hard to kind of battle with a lot of these questions. For me to go through that experience, I did mature and I did grow and learn how to deal with these kinds of disrespectful attitudes from other people. And it was through that process that I ultimately became stronger in the face of adversity. There are people in my life who are my North Star. So when I feel lost or when I feel like I'm uncertain about, you know, why I made a decision to go somewhere or do something, there are people in my life that I trust I can turn to, and they'll listen to me and they'll hold up a mirror for me and say, you know, Anika, is this really what you want? Why are you doing this? And, you know, no matter what the answer is, I'm here to support you. I'm here to be with you and trust you, and sort of hold you up when things get hard. And so those people in my life are, you know, my reason for living. Growing up, I often felt a lot of pressure because, you know, I am quote unquote a successful woman in STEM in terms of, I've been able to publish papers and make certain scientific advancements on things. And so over the years, that term, woman in STEM, has been a really complicated term for me because sometimes it's a term that I'm proud of. It's like, you know, I made it here and I have a right to be here. But other times I feel like it can be limiting because sometimes I see myself as, you know, going more into the arts or humanities. And what about just encouraging people to pursue their passions? If you are a woman who's in a STEM field right now, you know, there might be a point where you sometimes feel like you have a strange relationship with this phase because you're here just for the sake of quote unquote inclusion. But, you know, are there really systems in place to make sure that your voice is heard and that your ideas are being registered? And so I think that's something that I hope to sort of shed light on, because I know when we talk about this phrase woman in STEM, it's done in an overtly positive light, but I think it's a very nuanced term. I think it's really important for an agent of change to empathetically listen. And so for me, I've always loved storytelling as a way to empathetically listen to others, because I believe that everyone has a story to tell and has a story that they're interested in listening to. And so as an artist and documentary filmmaker, that's sort of been the way that I listen to, you know, the stories and experiences of other people, of other communities, both locally and around the world. Another way that, another aspect I think of being a change maker is provoking people to think bigger, to sort of question current societal norms. That's something that I always strive to do with my art. I don't want to be the one to tell you how things are. I want to show you, and you can come up with your own belief or assumption about, you know, the way the world does or doesn't work. And so I love inciting other people to just think and come up with their own perspective and just, be critical about the way things are. And do they really have to be that way? Why are they that way? Can we make them be another way? So those questions, I think I love to just drawing up more questions for myself, for other people, because I think there really are no clear answers. For all of us, part of the journey of being human is this process of questioning. You know, I think sometimes we're told this myth of when you're an adult, you'll just know everything, you know, everything's gonna be smooth and everything has a black and white answer. And I think we can all say that, you know, that's not true. I mean, let me know if there's someone who thinks that's true and I'd like to learn from them. but, you know, I think going off this realization that life is always a journey and, you know, all of us are just sort of always still figuring it out in some way or another. I think it's always really powerful to just reflect back on, you know, what did I learn in the past 6 months? How did I change in the past 6 months or the past year or the past 5 years? And it's kind of only when we start to bring up this measuring stick to ourselves and our personal experiences that, you know, we can start to understand and track growth. And so I think that's something that is useful for anyone to do in terms of just grounding oneself, thinking about, you know, how far you've come along in your own journey. And then, you know, taking that measuring stick and applying it to your community, you know, thinking about, you know, where did I grow up? How has that place changed or not changed over a certain amount of time? Or America, you know, how has America changed or not changed, or the world, et cetera. But I think, you know, sort of zooming out, looking at the big picture, thinking about, again, just reflecting on how did things get here? Are we going where we want to go? If not, how can I open more conversations about this? How can I get other people to think about this with me? You know, whether I'm a professor and I'm thinking about, you know, I just finished my R1 grant, you know, what next grant do I want to do? You know, why not talk to your colleagues and see what's that unspoken thing that everyone's thinking about, but, you know, not vocalizing about, you know, that's like, this is the future problem we need to address. Or, you know, if you're a student, thinking about, you know, what answer am I being fed by, you know, society or certain institutions in terms of, oh, you should study this because you'll get a career in this, versus where do you really think that, you know, humanity and this planet is heading, and what do you think your role could be in that? And, you know, even if you don't have a clear-cut answer, just beginning to think about those things and beginning to think about what specific talents and skills that you have that are unique to you could sort of contribute to that in your own way. I think just all of those questions can be really helpful to reflect upon.